And I wasn't cold. My feet weren't gonna fall off. My hand wasn't gonna...
You might thaw out and then you get to walk back.
Exactly.
And we should just go to the library.
Yeah.
Now, we still have the mic in the room, so I figured everything out.
On this mic. I told you for news that they can't...
Everybody use this, you can. Okay.
Well, it is so.
Aw, this room makes me love. Right. There's so many, like you're saying, I had to...
I guess the look is...
No, she hasn't been here.
Thank you.
Oh, you got me sitting there. You sit there. I think the knowledge needs to be spread.
Comes over here.
All over. Back to the middle.
With your arm up there.
That's too close. That's too close.
I should, isn't that bad? Hello, my con. Your name pops in my head again. And then when I try typing, I'm like, I'm not right anymore.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, I am no longer. No.
Yeah, well, you're the artist formerly known as.
But see, I'm tempted on both sides. I'm trying to be good. I'm self-control. I'm well on the bed.
Says I don't know, so I'm just working on myself.
Hi, Shannon,
what can you do? I'm Melissa Payne, I work downtown, yeah.
Aaron knows.
Okay.
With Bullet.
Same thing. Admissions or?
I do everything. I'm charged with support.
Gotcha, yeah. I know how that is.
Yeah, it's really, really helpful.
Taylor does the sword here downtown, yeah. Well, I didn't know him, so I wanted to...
Well, it's very nice to meet you.
Aaron and
Shannon.
No. Because I was going to represent. So I have originally during the ceremony, we weren't supposed to have the carols.
I always notice that students don't really sit in the
car. Hi, how are you?
Okay.
So I'm completely shocked.
You gotta wait till the red light to get past my body yet. Trust me, you don't
want it. Hi, how are you? I'm doing well, thank you.
I just dumped mine out and I'm waiting for the red light to come on. Yeah. Feel free to dump it in here.
Yeah.
Oh,
I'm just going to get refilled water. I'm gonna watch it.
Is it good?
Look at my elbows right there.
I think it's
So it's very interesting, and that's why we went there. So
first time.
How was it going?
That's an English you remember.
At least they invented that.
Alright, we got ready to get started. The clock on the wall says 9:25, but I think it's a few minutes later.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Thanks for coming out on this bitter, windy, cold morning. What a great day to be indoors and have some coffee whenever it gets hot and some donuts and be together. So thanks for coming. Today, we're really pleased to have with us our trainer from the system office, Derek Harris. He is the official PeopleSoft trainer and writes all your tutorials and things like that. And of course, Kim is right here, Kim Hayden, everyone has met before, I'm sure, also from the system office and technology solutions. They're going to talk to us today about the application, and this is your chance. I know you sent some questions ahead of time, but let's fully take advantage of them being here with us. Any questions that you have, problems that you've run into in working with students, or just that you've experienced, this is our day to really get some good answers and some good tips about how to be successful with interacting with the application. I know everybody in this room does not know each other, because I do not know everybody in this room, so we're going to cut into their time just a couple of minutes. And I'd like for us to go around and just say your name, which campus you're from, and what your primary role is. And I'll start. I should have started first. I'm Laura Smith, and I'm Dean of Students for the Downtown Technical and Carrollton campuses.
Jennifer Wood, Assistant Director of Admission.
Trevor Lucas, Downtown Campus. I work in the Admissions Office in the Call Center.
Jones, Downtown Campus, Admissions Center.
Sharon Loring, Shelby County Campus.
Downtown Campus, Academic Advising Office.
Angie Hennis, Downtown Campus Assessment Coordinator.
Brandon Herring, Downtown Campus, working admissions, new student orientation.
And I'm Kim Hayden, Technology Solutions System Office.
I'm Beth Dixon, I work downtown in the Records Office, outgoing transcripts.
Aaron Nuz, Bullitt Campus, and I do student orientation.
Shannon Wallace, Bullitt Campus, and I work with the Student Services.
Debbie Cotton, Adult Student Center, Downtown Campus.
Yvette Downs, Downtown Campus, Admissions Office.
Terry Martin, Accessibility Services, Downtown Carrollton, and Campus.
Sarah Dunaway, Advisor Coordinator, Southwest Campus.
Rob Harrington, Admissions Advisor, Recruitment Everywhere.
Her office is
I'm
at
the tech
I'm Chanda Rybski, Manager of New Student Recruitment and Admissions Advising, and my office is in Southwest.
Melissa Payne, Downtown Admissions Office.
Joe Street, Downtown Admissions SOAR.
Delana Kennedy, Downtown Admissions.
Krista Bowles, Downtown Records.
Vicki Johnson, Downtown Records.
Shirley Hayes, Downtown Records.
Brian White, Downtown Recruiter.
I think there's one thing Jeffrey wanted me to tell everyone before we start is that the microphone is very sensitive. We're recording this session. So he said anything, even like crinkling of chips or side conversations, will be caught on the microphone. So he just wanted to remind everyone of that.
All right, for our new additions, we were just going around doing introductions, so if you could just say your name and which area that you work in. Are you signing in?
Oh, sorry. Sorry that we're late. My name is Heather Yoakum, and I work as a counselor at the Carrollton campus.
I'm Sandy Banks, and I'm records at Carrollton.
Thank you, Laura, for the introduction. Again, my name is Derek Harris. I work at the system office. I do PeopleSoft training. So this session is for you all. So my plan is to go through the admissions application kind of step by step, show some things that you might not be aware of or some things we have frequently asked questions about. And there's also a list of questions that we got before the training session. I plan to address all those questions either throughout the session or at the end if I don't cover it while I'm going through the application. And if any time you have any question, raise your hand or interrupt me, and I'll answer it. And if I can't answer it, I'll ask Kim, and she'll answer it. So anything you guys have questions about, just let me know. So this is the new admissions application. Has everybody seen this? At least looked at it one time?
Yeah.
Familiar with it? So this is our test version. So whatever I do here today, it's not going to impact PeopleSoft. You're not going to go in and clean up a mess after me. But you see we have our KCTCS logo comes in at the top left-hand corner. One of the new things about this application and is that this logo has changed, the branding will change depending on which college the applicant selects. So after the student starts the application, they select Jefferson, it's going to display Jefferson's branding. And then throughout the application, they're going to get notifications specifically targeted from Jefferson's admissions office. So all their emails are going to be tailored to what your school offers. So you're not going to get, they're not going to get some kind of standard boilerplate message like the previous application. However, in order to do that, we had to use some of the latest browser technology. So whenever an applicant comes to the website, they're going to see this message at the top. So the application is only working with Internet Explorer 9 or older. So if they have, you know, Internet Explorer 8, an older browser, it's not going to work. It's going to display a really weird-looking page. So one of the first things we want to do is just give them instructions on how to update their browser. So if they have one of these older browsers, they can click here, just show them what they need to do to get a new browser. And if they have, I'm going to try to change the compatibility settings. So I think I can make this emulate an older browser to show you what it looks like. But if they come in with, like, let's say Internet Explorer 8, they should get a little yellow bar at the top of the page that says, basically, you can't use the application with this browser. I'm going to change that.
Can I ask one question?
Yes.
So does it give you an option to download it for free?
It does.
Okay.
And it also depends upon how the machine is set up, but it also will pop up a message that tells the student or the applicant that they're using an old browser that's not compatible.
Okay.
And that message they can click on.
Right.
But if you have, every machine is set up differently. So if you have a pop-up blocker, for instance, on your machine, mm-hmm. you don't get that pop-up message that says you got an old browser. So that's why we put the message also on the screen. But we do have the ability to detect it and say you've got an old browser.
Thank you.
So I changed the settings. So you see this yellow bar at the top that didn't appear there before. So now Internet Explorer is acting like Internet Explorer 8, even though it's IE11. And it gives that yellow message. So you can see right away what's going to happen if you're running an older browser. But again, for those who have a pop-up blocker, like Kim said, it's going to give you this message anyway. So we really try to address up front the things they need to do to make sure the application works smoothly while they're using it.
I have a question.
Yeah.
If it's not Internet Explorer and it's something like Firefox or Mozilla, that's okay too though, right?
Yeah, that's okay too.
It's actually better, honestly, because Internet Explorer is a really, unfortunately, it's a really quirky browser. Whereas any version of Firefox works. It doesn't matter how old it is, it works. It works. So. In general, we try to tell a help desk to just recommend to the student to use Firefox, just because it doesn't matter what version it is. It works on all versions.
So if they have no internet issues, the first thing they see is what they need to have to begin the application. It lets them know they need to have their social security number, an email address, and some information about their high school and any colleges that they've attended college before. So another new thing about the application is the previous application you just kind of started, but basically everybody, UK, you know, all these other schools around the state, allow students to create an admissions account. So they can start the application. If they can't finish it in one sitting, let's say they have to go back and get some information about their high school or college, they can resume it at a later time. So that's one of the features of this application, is that you can create, you should have to create an account before you begin. So, and it tells you if you, to create the account, you have to have an existing email address. So pretty much every student has an email address. Most of them might not even realize it. Technically, Facebook is, you know, you can use it as an email address. But if they don't have an email address they're used to using, we give them information here about how to get an email account. And so when you click this link, it's going to give them information about some free, high-quality email providers, like Microsoft's Outlook.com, Google, Gmail, Yahoo, and maybe one more. So there's three or four different good options they have if they don't already have an existing email address. On the right-hand side, so let's say that the student has begun their application, they needed to stop for whatever reason and resume it later. So on the right-hand side, we have the place for them to resume their application. And so this is something we've had a few questions on. So how does somebody reset their password? So a little bit confusing with the new app. So there are two different passwords that a student may have. So there's a password for the application itself. So that's the one after they start the application, they'll go through a few pages and they'll create a password just for the application. And it's not going to be the same as they'll use for PeopleSoft. It could be if they set it up that way, but it's not necessarily the same. So the other one is your actual PeopleSoft student self-service password. So throughout the application, if the student enters some information and an application determines, hey, they already have access to student self-service, most of the time they're not going to need to complete a whole new application. And we have some new things called online forms to either change their home college, change their major, or to change their, or to do a readmission application. So if they have access to student self-service, a lot of times the application is going to say, hey, you need to log into self-service to do this and not complete another application. And so in that case, they may need to reset their password for self-service. So just keep in mind, if a student needs to reset their passwords, there's two different options, and to really figure out which one they need to reset. Is it for the application itself or for PeopleSoft student self-service? So they would enter their email address and password if they've already have an application. If they do forget their password for the application, they can click this Forget Your Password link. And that'll prompt them with a password reset question. So in the application, it'll ask you to create like a reset question like, what's your mother's maiden name, or what was the name of your first pet? They would enter that, and it would send an email to the account they use, the email account they use to create the application. So if the student tries to reset it, just make sure that they have put the correct email address they use to start the application, because that could be another. If they have several different email addresses, just make sure that they're checking the right one when they try to reset their password.
So, one question, sorry. So I'm thinking about the person that's not here. The way you're talking is like the someone that's here with us. So how does a student know that's at home? Is there a message that pops up that says this is not the same password that you may have created for people, or self-service? Is there something that helps someone at home?
So after they start the application, they'll get an email, just like a welcome email, like, hey, thanks for starting your application, blah, blah, blah. If you need to resume it, click this link. And so if they do need to save and stop it, they can just access that link in their email inbox.
Gotcha.
And bring them to this page.
So once they start it, it's an email that comes to them that says, this is your username and password you created for this account.
Yeah, I don't think it sends them the password of the email, because that's not a security
right,
system,
okay,
but
it'll
tell them their email address. And
but there is some reference that they could read.
There is.
Thank you. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it even says, as soon as that account's created, it goes to the message goes to the email that was used here, and it does say, just remember your username is this email account, is this email address, and then it, like Derek said, it gives them the hyperlink back to this landing page. But we can't put the password in there.
Yeah, for sure, yeah.
But they can reset it right from here.
Okay.
And what we did find out, and Jennifer probably just let you all know, is that there was some confusion with the Blackboard agents on this whole discussion. So instead of directing students automatically to the online app and letting the online app figure out if the student already had self-service or not, they were sending them, I don't really know why, but they were sending them to the user account center first, which doesn't make any sense. So I know that we've worked on that locally to try to address that, but also I have a meeting with the Blackboard leadership team, I think on Thursday, to make sure that all the agents have the right information.
Another question too, sometimes we have students that are applying at different KCTCS colleges, so how does this process work for them if they apply for Jefferson and they decide to apply for Bluegrass or vice versa?
As soon, they can only complete one online application. So as soon as that online application is loaded into PeopleSoft, then they get student self-service access. And that email that they get, Jefferson's email, also includes the information on setting up their user account once they've applied through the user account center. So they have information on how to set their account up to get into PeopleSoft. And then from then on out, they'll have student self-service access, and they can complete the change of home college form. So we really don't want our students applying to, you know, four or five different KCTCS colleges. They really do need to choose one. And if they want to move from the original application college to a different one, they just complete that change of home college form.
Thank you. I have a question. After they complete the application, how long does it take for their user account center to be activated? Is it automatically or?
It's with the no longer than 2 hours. So.
And that's after they complete the whole form. So they can't get like halfway into it and then it creates the student self-service account?
That's correct. They actually have to submit the application. Okay. And in Jefferson's letter, in your welcome letter, it tells them that too. It says, you know, your user account will be activated within 2 hours of applying.
So. One more question. So the online forms allows a student to change the home campus, right? So if they're applying to Jefferson and then they say, oh, well, I wanted to also apply to Bluegrass, and they go in and do this online form change thinking that they're going applying to both? Is there some way we can stop them from doing multiples? Like, we need to be able to let the student know that you can't do this. If you want Jefferson, if that's your preferred choice, but Bluegrass is a side option, they need to understand that changing that will affect getting a letter from Jefferson or vice versa.
Right.
Is there something we can put in there to stop that?
Well, we do, in the change of home college form, we do explain what happens when you change from one college to the other, and that the new college then becomes your college. Okay. And supports you. Okay. Supports your financial aid and all of those decisions. Now, granted, students aren't going to read that. We know they don't read much. So, I mean, I'm not sure what we can do to make that better.
No.
But if you all have any suggestions.
I'm asking that on a personal level. I was sent a request. It was actually a social media request where a student was like begging to get their letter from us. And I was asked to look into it and see, can we get them a letter? And when I looked, they were set for Somerset. So they would never have heard from us because they went in and did the change form, but she's on the internet hollering about, I've never got a letter from Jefferson.
So just think about it. If you all have suggestions on ways that we can improve that, we actually do have a long list of feedback that we've gotten on the forms themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And if we have time, we can share some of the things that we're going to be changing about that, about those online forms.
And I do realize we have a second session. If these questions that I'm asking should wait till that second session after?
I would say no. Okay. I'm guessing that the recruiters and others are going to get the same questions.
Okay.
So whenever it pops in your head, just ask.
Thank you.
And my other question, too, is when they fill out the application, they are getting their student ID number, so that way they can access their student self-service account if they needed to do the change home campus form?
Yes. So right on the screen, the only time they don't get their student ID number on the screen when they complete the application is if we've done a search match and there are more than one person that matches that, or if it was suspended. Trying to think of the different suspense reasons. If it was suspended because they couldn't find their school code,
which is happens a lot, but we'll talk.
They get their application reference number.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if they don't get their IMPL ID, they at least get their application reference number, and that number can be used to reset their. It's at the user account center. Also, it only takes, there seems to be a lot of confusion about that, but it only takes two pieces of information. So if the student knows their social security number and they know their personal email address, that's all they need.
Or that reference number, right? Because at first, when we first launched this, I was thinking about the person at home that we're not here to help, you know. And if they forgot their ID number from years ago or their personal email address they used from years ago, it's hard for them to move on with completing the application.
Correct.
And I think me and you talked about this a little bit, about maybe getting it to give the ID number immediately. But it sounds like the reference number can be used in place. And then your social, and that's all you need.
That's correct.
Right? Okay.
That's correct.
So one more question, I'm sorry. Lucas, when y'all are working with students, does those two options work? The reference number and like a social, or the reference
and... Sometimes we have trouble with that. But if we use like the social and the email address,
mm-hmm.
if it happens that they can remember that, mm-hmm. it always goes through.
Okay.
Sometimes if we use like a social... and a student ID number, then it won't let them go ahead. It won't recognize them. It won't be able to find them. It says your user account cannot be located.
And I think that comes from the social not being in there, or
no,
maybe
that
wrong.
Comes from the misinformation from the agents. Because if the account is not active, it's not going to recognize it. And it's going to say, even if you have the social security number and you have the IMPL ID, mm-hmm. if that account's not active, it's going to say, we can't find your account because it didn't exist. So the only time they should be going to that user account center is if we know for sure that they already have student self-service access. And so that's why we say, please direct everybody to start with the app. Because what the app does is it does a search in PeopleSoft as they're completing it to see if they have self-service access.
So these are students that we are doing this with.
Yes, what we found was that agents weren't letting them start the app.
Gotcha.
I don't know why, but it was just misinformation.
Well, sometimes what I run into, though, is, I mean, there have been times it's taken almost 45 minutes to get through this process because we direct them to this website. We go try to do the application, and then it won't go through. And then we try to do student self-service account, and then that won't work.
Yeah.
And then we have to do a paper app. And
yes.
So then by that time, we're spending so much to try to get the application. So I guess, and that's where part of my confusion comes in too, because if a student had, so a student would have to fill a new application for admissions to get the reference ID number, then to,
no.
Mm-hmm.
So they only start, once you start the app.
All right.
You either have to start the app and get enough information so that we can do a search match within, we use what's called a web services call. So it actually goes into PeopleSoft as they're completing this first page and does a search match. So at that point, if they already have self-service access, it pops up a message and says, something like, you know, you, congratulations, you don't have to complete an app. You already have access to PeopleSoft self-service. Complete the readmission form or the change of home college form or the change of major form to complete any of those functions.
But it doesn't give them any information then, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it doesn't give them their ID number or anything.
Reference number.
Right, ID. And then if they don't remember that, they, especially like we have dual credit students who don't even
access to their student self-service, they can get their student ID number off of student self-service.
Yeah, so it depends. I mean, it depends upon the student. That's why it's not a black and white answer. So if they're a currently active student, they should know what their password is already. So they don't always have to reset that password.
Our problem occurs a lot of times with the dual credit students because a lot of times they've never even been in their account. They don't even know that. They should know, they've been sent their ID number, but they've never set that account up. And if they get ready to do an application, they hit that wall and it says you can't do one, they can't go to the user account and set up their account because they don't know that information to set it up. And a lot of times, they don't even know what email address they gave because it was done on a dual credit application 2 years ago. You know, so they don't even remember, it might have been mom's, it might have been theirs. You see the problem
Here's the confusion, Kim. What you're saying, when the student goes through this and then it recognizes them in the system and then it automatically refers them to the self-service to set that up, that won't work. Even if they have the two identifying factors, it still says your user account cannot be found. So then they are stuck to do a paper application because the web app won't let them do it. And then they can't set up the user account center for some reason.
Okay. If that ever occurs, then I need to know that.
The ID number. Jennifer and I talked about this the other day, and she asked me.
Yeah, we need to know who that student was because, you know, if there are options, and did we provide documentation on the user account center?
Yeah, we did. So they need four pieces of information besides the date of birth. So they need two of the four, actually. They need either their KCTCS ID, Social Security number, app reference number, or the personal email. So any two of those four in addition to their date of birth should let them reset the password.
So I've noticed that if you put four things, because most students are like not reading that, just two of the following, they're putting all four. And it will not work if you put more than two things in there.
I agree.
Yes.
I agree. Yeah. I always tell them just to put two because
yeah,
that's
reason, what they're supposed to do.
The more they put,
they don't read that message. So they put four and they're like, I can't get it to go through, you know. Mm-hmm. I just think that we need to work on trying to get an app that's compatible for someone that's here in office and at home.
Okay. Well, remember, these are two different things.
Okay.
So the user account center is really a separate thing from the application and from the application process. So the user account center is for all of our students, whether or not they are new applicants or they're currently enrolled students. That's where they go to reset their password for their email, for everything. So if there's issues with the user account center and it not working properly, mm-hmm. then we need to know that. That is kind of a separate discussion from the admissions process.
Okay.
So, and I don't want to get too much into that,
yeah.
but the user account center is going away and is being replaced by something that is much more like what we're doing with the admissions account. So it is a lot more automated for the student. It'll be a lot easier for them to reset their passwords. It is going away. But unfortunately, I don't work on the user account center.
Mm-hmm.
But as soon as we can get some sort of a demo of that, I'd be happy for you all to see that. But mm-hmm. I would say within the next 3 months, that user account center will be replaced with a new version.
Okay.
The students that are doing the new application for the first time, or however it is, I guess like a transfer student, does it give them a message saying you don't have access to your student self-service for 2 hours? So we have a lot of students come to the office that we've tried to set up the account for, and it kicks them out. So I assume it's because of there they haven't waited 2 hours or more, but.
That's correct. So the email, I think we gave you a documentation of the email that Jefferson students get and what information is included in that. So I would suggest you get, especially if you're ones that work directly with those applicants, get comfortable with what that message says, and you can redirect them to go back to their email account. Say, oh, everything you need is right here.
If only we could make everyone read.
Yeah. Did we give you the wrong message?
Welcome email after submitting.
Oh, that's a checklist. Okay. Yeah, I saw you telling me that.
I guess you could talk about the welcome email comes immediately, right? And then the checklist items come 7 days later, which I'm sure Derek will talk about.
Sure. We'll talk about it now.
That's why there are two emails.
Yeah, so in your handouts, there's one that says, welcome email after submitting app. So as soon as the student or the applicant finishes the application, we'll give them their ID number on the screen, and it'll also give them the application reference number. But then in their email inbox, they'll have this email that's they selected Jefferson as their home college. It'll give them this Jefferson welcome email. It has all this stuff that you all have put together for the students and what they need to do to follow Jefferson's process. They choose a different college, they're going to get a different an email that's from that college, but it comes right away. As soon as they click submit, the process runs, they get the email in their inbox. There's another one, and it says E-Town on it, so it'll be basically the same except the logo is different. So I just use the first one I came across. So this other one says checklist items email to students. So 7 days after the application is submitted, the system will look to see any checklist, or the students will know them as to-do list items. So any to-do list items the student has to do, you know, like sending in test scores or orientation required, or any like custom Jefferson items that you assign to students, anything that's on their account after 7 days is going to go out an email to say, hey, you need to follow up with these items. So that's 7 days after they submit the application. And the reason that's not right away is because every college is different, so every college may have different to-do list items for students. Some require orientation, some don't, some, you know, so different things are going to drive that. So 7 days later, they'll get this email. And I think it follows up with them periodically. Is that correct, Kim? If they don't complete the checklist items after a certain time, is there like a reminder email?
No.
Is it just once?
I have a question. So is the checklist, that's not the same as the welcome letter that's being sent out?
No, it's not. So it's just going to look at their student self-service center and look at their to-do list items. And like this one just has a test results link. So it could have a lot of different things. It could have several items.
Transcripts or whatever the student has to do to complete their admissions process for your college.
I have a question about the email. Are the email, the Jefferson email account, are they going to be open to the students sooner than enrolling for a class? Because that becomes a problem, especially like on the welcoming letter. They ask them to send an email to the records office to register themselves for classes, and we're unable to register for classes if they don't have a .edu account.
So when is that done in the process?
I'm sorry, I missed the first part.
So they need to have
a KCTCS email account.
Okay. They don't get a KCTCS email account until they enroll.
Until a class, yeah.
So, but they do have access to student self-service this, 2 hours after they apply. Mm-hmm. So there's a little bit of confusion about that. The email account doesn't get created until they enroll, but that doesn't mean they don't have access to self-service. So those are two different things.
Yeah, but a lot of times they can't enroll in some classes.
Like prerequisites, I think is what she's trying to say. If they require prerequisites, they can't do it themselves. So then Jefferson requires them to email from a .edu email. If they can't, if they don't have one, then they can't get help. I think that's more of a in-house.
Mm-hmm. That's an in-house thing.
Yeah.
Well, if it says on that second page where it's under prepare for registration, it says non-freshman.
Yeah.
So that would either be somebody transferring or somebody who's been here before. So they should have an EDU, I would think.
Well, just, I mean, if they've not been in school for a couple of years, they don't have access anymore. That's the only dilemma, Laura.
Okay.
A lot of them do still have it, but some don't.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they have to come in?
Yeah.
And that decision is...
Local.
No, when that email account is a decision that you can have impact.
Oh, yeah.
So there's been a lot of discussion from colleges saying, why don't we just go ahead and give them an EDU email address when they apply? And we can do that. So it really is a decision that the student leadership at the colleges just need to have a discussion about and make a recommendation. You know, from the system office, we don't really care. It's really whatever you all, whatever makes most sense for you all.
I have another thing, because I'm just,
okay.
For me, it's the flow on the, okay, so when the student goes in, they put the application in, and then when they get that initial email, and maybe I'll do something, is there something in the next level of communication that explains to the student how to set up their user account? Because when you look at the checklist email to students, in the third paragraph, it says, if you need assistance with this process, or have any questions, visit the student service center. Well, some of them may not even set up their student service account.
On the first email they get, on the second page, it says set up your student user account profile. And it goes through the process of what they need to do to set it up.
On the second page, it tells you how to set it up.
So the welcome email comes, is that the one they get immediately after they submit?
Immediately?
Yes.
Okay. So it's on the, it's close to the bottom of that page.
Okay, gotcha.
I'm very sorry to fill out this application so we don't run out of time. But these are great questions, y'all.
I'm the line of the application. You know, we've gotten to the point where a student has gone in, started their app, and maybe stopped and had to come back.
Uh-huh.
So then it prompts them to do the readmissions application. So for us downtown, we've encountered that link there. Let's say they completed the application and it didn't go all the way through. They go back in, and so then they'll go into existing. It'll tell them you have an existing application on file. Okay, so then it prompts them to go to the student self-service. Well, when they get there, there's not a link, a button there for them to fill out the readmit application.
So it works a little differently than that. So let's say the student started the application but didn't submit it. Then they just log back in using the email address that they used to create the app and their password.
To finish. And
when they do that, it pulls that application back up. It won't redirect them to self-service. So if they don't realize they can do that thing. Spilled coffee up here. This is why they don't put. And I talk with my hands. So then if they, let's say that they think they can just start all over again and they start the app, that they get a different message. It says, you already have an application that's been started but not submitted. Log back in and retrieve that saved application and complete it. It doesn't redirect them to self-service.
Mm-hmm. I'll work with you best, so I kind of know what she's saying. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the student is redirected to do the readmissions at versus the whole entire application. Mm-hmm. When we help them log into self-service, that readmissions application link is not there. Mm-hmm. And I think this goes back to us needing to give you some examples.
Yes.
Yeah.
Has that been a while?
It's been since we started, yes. You know.
Because we did make some significant changes in what I would call the logic of when the forms up display or not. Mm-hmm. And those changes occurred in, I want to say, November. So initially, we did find students that had self-service access, but they didn't fit the logic of when a form would display or not. So we made changes to that. So as of November, you shouldn't be seeing that.
Okay.
So if the student gets redirected, they should have that readmissions form.
Would you say?
If it ever occurs, and that's not the case, mm-hmm. please let us know and we'll take a look at
sure.
it. But since November, you shouldn't be seeing that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And in one of the handouts we have, there's online forms availability. And this is a demonstration of the logic that Kim was talking about. So basically, it's a readmission application. There's three types of students that would have that link available to them. The first would be high school students. So high school students would need this because after they do their dual credit or whatever, if they want to apply again as a first-time freshman, they would use the readmission application since they already have self-service. The second type would be visiting students. So visiting students, you know, they're taking a couple of classes or whatever, if they want to do a fee transfer student and enroll full-time or part-time or whatever, then they would complete the readmission application, basically change their student status from a from a visiting to a transfer. And the third type would be somebody that's not enrolled in any of the terms. So they're not enrolled in the current term or future term. And they're going to have all three of the links available. So they could do the change of home college, the change of major, and they could also do the readmission application. So those are kind of the three scenarios where they would have that link available. So in the situation you're talking about, if the student maybe is enrolled in a class for the summer, then that's not going to be available to them.
So one question then. So we require visiting students here in Jefferson to reapply each semester. Are you saying that's not, that link is not going to be available because they...
All the visiting students, it's going to be available.
It will with them. Okay, thank you.
So regardless of their status, all visiting students will we'll always see that form. One. All high school students will always see that form.
Perfect. Thank you.
So the first thing the student comes to after they actually start the application, it asks them to select their college. So they choose their college and campus, and then based on that choice, this is what changes the branding and all the communications. So now that they've chosen Jefferson, the top left corner you're going to see the Jefferson logo. They're going to get the Jefferson welcome email after they complete. And so we talked about like the two different accounts. So the logic check is done after the student enters the information down to the date of birth. So it's going to check their first name, their last name, their social security number, and date of birth. And if that matches somebody else in PeopleSoft, that's what's going to give them the message they need to go to student self-service.
I'm sorry, is the Social Security required?
The Social Security is not required, but it is encouraged.
Okay.
And so it's...
can they proceed without it, though? I mean, will they be able to proceed with it? Okay.
They can.
Okay. But they do get messages. Okay. So it'll say, you forgot to put your Social Security number in. And so it does give the illusion
does it say something about financial aid?
It says for financial aid.
I gotcha. Okay. Yeah. Sorry, Derek.
So this invisible text here in the middle kind of explains that. So I'm going to leave it blank just to show what it does. So, but at this point, it's going to check all this information. If the student has an account and they put a Social Security in, it might do a match in PeopleSoft if there's one existing. Next, it just asks for a home or present address. Kind of cool because you can put in your zip code and it puts in your city and state automatically. And at the bottom on the first page, this is where it's going to ask them to create their admissions account. So this is their personal email address. And they just confirm it. They make up a password that's got to be 8 characters and use can use one lowercase and one wildcard. And this is their password reset hint question. So there's a couple options, mother's maiden name or name of first pet. And so this, the only time they would use that is if they need to reset their password just for this admissions account. And with all that in, they click the create account. And so this is what makes it seem like maybe to the students that you have to put in your Social Security number. So it just prompts them to give them information about keys and financial aid and et cetera. So at this point, it brings them back to the field. they can enter their social security number or they can skip it. Just for demonstration, I'm just going to skip it to you. It does work. So the second time you click create account with a blank social security number, it will go through. So it's not required, but it is encouraged. And whenever we're doing the design of the admissions application, that was what everybody seemed to want, was, you know, to encourage that, because a lot of our students do get financial aid, and financial aid students do need to have that number in there. So I think it's 80-something percent of our students, maybe more, receive federal financial aid. So it doesn't behoove us to leave that field out, because it's just going to have to be data gathering that at another point in time anyway.
And you may be aware, I don't know, that your college also gets fined. There's a fee that we have to pay federal government for every student that doesn't provide their social security number. So that's new. So even though we can't take it, can't require it, then for 1098-T processing, it's a required field. And so that's why this past year, students were being asked to provide that social security number if they had left it blank. So it becomes more and more important all the time.
It's pretty pricey. B2 is like $50 per student.
It's crazy.
So after you create the account, at this point, if I were to check my email, I would have an email saying thank you for creating your admissions account, and at least that. And I might bring that up after I finish. But the rest of this is just to confirm that what you've entered already is correct. And we'll go to the next step. The next page, this is all optional information. So you can see that, well, anytime the next button is blue, that means that you can go on to the next page. That means you fill out all the required fields. I think in the testing, something like 90% of students actually fill out most of these fields, but they are all optional. So the next page is the citizenship page. You can see here that the next step icon is grayed out, so you couldn't just click ahead here, so they do have to fill in some information. And this is adaptive too, so all the questions don't show up at once. So if I were to say yes, it's going to allow me to go on to the next step, because that's all the information we need for a U.S. citizen. But if it's not, it's going to give me some more prompts. So it's going to ask about the permanent resident, parolee, or refugee. And then, depending on how you ask that, it kind of like, it's adaptive, so it's going to do different questions for whatever your response is. So it keeps this application from being like unwieldy and too long. I'm just going to keep it simple so we can go to the next page. So this is the ethnicity questions page, and this is something we've had a few questions about. So people ask, well, I fill out the page, but then I can't go on to the next step. So let's say I fill out this page. All right, I've answered the questions. You click it, it's grayed out. You have to click this checkbox to go on to the next page. So, and really, you don't even have to, these are optional pieces of information too. So the student could just click this checkbox. If you read it, it says, the information is correct, or I decline to provide my ethnicity. So they could just click this box and go on. It's not real intuitive until you read to the very bottom of the page, but you have to click that button, and then you can go on. So you can see something else has changed. We've gone from the personal information to the application information. So the little indicator at the top kind of tells you what status you are as far as completing the application. So we've got about the first 20% or so done. And so the application information is going to ask you things about, you know, the college experience, more than just the personal biodemographic data. So it asks, when do you plan to start attending college? And the student will put in their term. And all these series of questions, these kind of drive several different things that people solve. They'll drive the admit type of the student, so they determine if this student is a high school student, is a first-time freshman, is this a transfer? So instead of asking the student what their student type is, because they never got that right. Like, even people that were experienced students always got that wrong. So we just had these series of questions, and if they can answer these correctly, then it'll give them the correct student type. So are you currently enrolled in high school? If I selected yes, what would the admit type for that student be?
First time freshman.
They're enrolled in high school. So what if I said, no, they're not currently in high school, and have you earned a high school diploma? Yes. And ask you when you graduated. Then, are you currently taking college classes? What if I say yes to this question? And do you plan to remain enrolled? So what would that person's admit type be? So they graduated?
It's a student.
They graduated high school, they're currently taking college classes, but they're going to remain at this college, the other college.
And Kelly said a visiting student.
Visiting student, exactly. But what if they do not plan to remain at that college?
Transfer.
And what if they've earned a high school diploma, but they're not taking college classes, and they've never taken college classes?
Freshman.
So depending on what the student chooses on these, it's going to give them their admit type. So we'll do a first-time freshman. So this asks about their high school experience. So one of the questions that we had for this session was, how many pieces of education history can we put for the students? So you can only put in one high school, so they can only enter one high school on this page. They can enter as many colleges as they want, so there's no limit to that, but there's only Illinois, they can put in one high school. So it prompts with Kentucky and USA, they can change this information. They can say they're homeschooled and they'll let them go on to the next screen. They put in part of their high school name and click search for school.
Can I have a question? I have a question about that.
Yes.
Why is this section of the application so sensitive? Is it because we have two different, like Jennifer and I talked about this the other day, how there's two different Butler high schools in the system. One says Butler, the other one says Suda Butler. Is that why it's so sensitive to, I just found a lot of the suspended apps that I work with are because, just simply because the school couldn't be found. Can we make it better where they don't suspend so much?
Well, the Butler High School would be for anyone who graduated from Butler probably before 1990. The Suda Butler would be where they made it a traditional high school. So it would probably be, and that would also depend on where you could find your transcript, too.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, but I don't think the system's thinking that way.
Well, it's suspending it because you choose one over the other, is that what you're saying?
If they just put Butler High School or just type Butler, or I can't even tell you what makes it do that. I just know that there's two different Butlers.
So
you know,
if the student clicks any of these, you're not going to suspend for that. So that's not an issue.
Okay.
But they click school not found,
and then type it in. Is that what it is?
To say Butler. They could add this school and do it that way. But if they just do Butler High School, there's no problem with that. It's going to work just fine.
And so, you know, the best we can do is just tell the student to, the less information is better.
Yeah.
So, you know, don't type in the full name of the school. Because it's looking for a match, so that's why we say a partial name is okay.
And it does say that. I think we talked about this first training. Yeah.
Yeah, but you know,
they type in Suda Butler, it's not gonna show up because we have it saved as Butler High School. And I guess that's my question: can we make a more universal name?
Yeah. So anytime that you have you see there's something weird going on with high school names, just let us know. So like in that case, we could actually hide that Suda Butler from this search, so that the only one that shows up is Butler High School. But we can, there's thousands of high schools, thousands and thousands of schools in the database. And so we're not like you all. We are not going to see the same high schools over and over again. So if there's anything like that, you just need to let us know.
Okay.
And we can go in and inactivate one of the other codes so that only that one shows up as their option there. So.
Okay.
And what we found is that, you know, that Eastern Kentucky University, for instance, was in the database like 10 times.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so when we started looking at, we did go through and try to clean up all of the regional universities, all of the state-funded universities, and any the private ones as well that we were aware of, and make sure that the student can only see one.
So in terms of CPE, as long as there's a school and people solve with the correct data or with data in the right spots, it's okay.
Correct.
So it doesn't matter if I select Butler or SUDA Butler.
Correct.
As long as the transcript's posted correct.
Correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So they have their one high score, and it's not going to let them add anything else. So they go on to the next page. And if I had selected that this was a visiting student or anything that's not like a first-time freshman, it would have asked me about the college experience. And that page, it would look exactly the same as searching for the high school, but they would put in their college information instead. The difference is they could add more than one college, so there's a way they can just keep searching and add more until they've entered all their college information. All right, so the next page is their program of study. So this is what's going to determine what's on the student's program plan pages. So like whether they're majoring in is associate in science, engineering technology. But they're first asked, are they planning to pursue a bachelor's degree at a four-year college or university? And so this question, along with one more, is going to maybe put a student group on their record. But that's the only thing this would do. Let's see. I'll say yes. So you're interested in only online classes. So only is the key word. So this is asking basically if they answer yes to this question and then yes to the following question, that's going to determine that they might be a potential learn-on-demand student. So unlike the previous application, this one doesn't separate and have like a regular application and learn-on-demand. It's all the same application, but if they do say yes and then yes, the next question about, are you interested in learning more about online classes? Then someone from the student services help desk will contact the student and say, hey, these are the options for online learning. Does this seem like a good fit for you? So we don't try to like pigeonhole them down the path towards learn on demand, but if they are the person that does want to study learn on demand and that path is good for them, then this kind of allows that to happen. But this by no means makes them, they're just a regular KCTCS student, so it's not going to determine them just by these questions. So now we select their program of study. So if I select yes to this question and yes to associate in arts, it's going to ask a follow-up question about the area of interest. And so this is basically used to help the advisor determine what the students should be studying since they've indicated they want to go on to pursue a four-year degree. If I'd selected no to this question, I wouldn't have this follow-up. It would just say, okay, you're associate in arts, that's fine. But since we say yes, they want to pursue a four-year degree, it's going to ask, you know, basically, what do you want to go on and major in when you switch to U of L or UK or whatever school? So we'll just pick the area of interest. And this just puts, I think, is it a student group, Kim, that this assigns?
A pathway student group.
A pathway student group. So it's a pathway student group to say.
Is there a way to do that in the reverse? Let them pick the program and then give them the actual major they need to be in? Because the problem we have is students wanting to be in business or something, and they want to transfer to a four-year college, and they want the business, but they really need to be an associate's in arts major. We have a lot of program changes based on that.
Not really. The way that that hierarchy works is that they do, based on the college that they chose, then we give them all of the program areas that your college offers degrees under. And then they click that program area, and then they can see the degrees that are offered under that program area. And I guess my feedback would be that you can't really, the admissions application is an admissions application, and it can't replace advising.
Exactly.
So no matter what you do, students are going to choose the wrong major.
But I got one question then.
They just don't, they don't really know and understand at the time that they're applying what their direction
is. Is there a question here that says, do you plan to apply for financial aid?
No.
It's not. Is that a, can we add that question? Because if we can, then we only give that student that say yes the option for financial aid eligible programs, because of what we find is that we're having to change programs for students because they're not aid eligible.
I think we have to make the assumption that all of our students are financial aid eligible, because we're at about a 90% population of our students. So
we just will give them an option to select a program that's not aid eligible, even though they told us.
If they do, though, they get a message right in the application process that mm-hmm. says, this degree program may not be eligible for financial aid. Are you sure you want to choose that?
Gotcha.
They're not seeing that message. I can guarantee you.
We just sent 800 students.
I mean, you can't force them to read the messages that they get, but they do get that message.
That message just come up.
So I just chose one to show that if you do select a certificate or diploma or anything that's not an associate's degree, they'll get this message. You're not may not be eligible for financial aid as a diploma or certificate seeking. So it's an information only. So it's just letting them know as they're doing it, hey. So if they choose to ignore that message, I mean, I feel like we've done as much as we can do on the application side to make that.
And block their access to the program just because they...
Yeah, sort of blocking access to let them choose it. We've done pretty much all we can do to say, hey, this is not eligible financial aid. So after they choose their plan, the next thing is the residency. So these series of questions determine if the student is a Kentucky resident or not. Yeah, so students will fill this out probably inaccurately, and then there's a process for them. If they say they do consider themselves a Kentucky resident, but they've answered these questions like, let's see. Yeah, so they say yes to this question. So we know that that's going to mean that they're not a Kentucky resident, but they say yes to the question down here. After they finish the application, on the screen when it gives them their student ID, their application reference number, it's also going to say, here's a link to the appeals form if you want to appeal that you're a Kentucky resident.
I have a question, comment. Can we put the wording in there that says, as of your start date? Because we have people applying like February who will be a resident by June, but they put no, and then they're forced through that appeal process because... Which is a really tedious process, because they simply didn't think ahead that, oh, well, I will be in August when I start, even though I'm not in February when I apply.
Or the same thing with the does either parent live outside of Kentucky? That's a set up question, because some parents' are dead, so they say no, you know. And then it's automatically.
Yeah, that kind of question probably should be in there too.
Or yes,
do you have parents living? Because I've had that situation too.
I think our residency questions are a little confusing to the applicant.
Okay, it does. Let's say a couple of things. So it does say, does either living here?
Okay, it does say living parent. Thank you for making me see that, Kim.
So what I would say is that any recommendations you have about the residency questions, mm-hmm. then you really need to direct those to your registrar and let her collect those and gather your feedback. Because the registrars have reviewed these questions and we've made modifications to them. And then they also have to be, we have to run those by CPE, because mm-hmm. there are those questions we have to ask those
questions.
And the reality is that we probably have more students that are getting residency than really should be. So I know we always want to try to do what we think is the best for our students, but you know, as a residency officer at your college, they may say, actually, no, that student really isn't a resident. So there are finite rules to determine who is a Kentucky resident and who isn't.
Yeah, I'll give one example. It might help everyone. It helped me. Amanda, I talked to her about one student that was a high school student here in Louisville. Their parent lived in another state, and that parent claimed them on their taxes. Technically, legally, that student is a non-resident because their parent is claiming them on taxes in another state. So that's, I understand what you're saying. And that, talking to Amanda helped me understand why that question, you know,
because they would be considered an in-state resident, whatever state the parent lived in.
Yes.
They could go to that university at in-state rate.
Exactly. So even though I don't agree or believe in that wholeheartedly, I understand it better.
Right.
And so just, I brought this, I'm with the dual credit program here. The only caveat I see with that that's really unfair to the student is it being a divorcee. I know that sometimes the agreement is you claim 1 year for one parent and another year for another. Fortunately, my ex-husband lives in a foreign country, so I don't have to worry about that. But for a lot of people, mm-hmm. that is 1 year you are, 1 year you aren't. And I would love to be in a situation where the dual credit students had someone advocating for them, that if the state is paying for their education, like our public school system is, they're considered residents. Mm-hmm. If you, the day before you graduate, you're not a resident, but the day after you graduate, you're a resident of Kentucky. And I'm sure you all are doing this because CPE has said these are the rules. It just seems like there needs to be somebody higher up that's using some common sense for these kids.
Well, because but I think that's where, even though the appeal process is horrid and cumbersome and overbearing and all of the horrible things that it is, none of us like it. Nobody in this room likes the appeal process. But in the appeal process, the situation like you described, they would probably be given concession. But they would not? If no. Say like next year you would be, or the no. next year when they are, no. when that parent's taxes then it's changed?
No, and then you're in a situation where you've already enrolled a student, and they owe that money. We've had quite, no, not for that reason, no. There could be other reasons, like the student felt like they were from Indiana or something, or were born in Indiana, but they'd really been here for 5 or 6 years, but no, we've had them denied for reasons like that because they can't show the proof that they or their parents have been here. Mm-mm. If you've got a father and they're claiming you on the taxes, you are a resident in that state. Mm-hmm. But next year it might be different. You see what I mean? And I'm really not. I know that there are rules that have to be followed. It just seems like, and then when they have to go do an appeal packet, I mean, we're talking about sometimes juniors have to show the divorce papers
right.
of their yeah. parents, and
let us
I'm just throwing it out there. That's all. I know we can't.
Yeah,
let's not derail on. Really, yeah. that's my fault. Yeah.
Sorry.
No, it's fun.
Yeah. Residency is disliked by all.
We'll leave it at that. And luckily, that's the last part of this application. So, we're moving on. This is just confirmation thing, so they can look over to make sure that everything looks. Correct, and then they can always step back if they need to make and go to the previous step.
I have a question. So yes. If you go to the previous step, does it erase?
No, it shouldn't. It should hold all their values.
Okay, so well, all right, good.
One back,
all right, good.
And it has all their old values, and as you go forward, it keeps that.
I have a question. If on any of these steps, like the student just exits out of this without saving anything and they go back in to pick up where they left off, will it take them directly back to where they left off, or do they have to save the information?
I think they have to save it. I know it's going to have like all the stuff they have when they created their application saved automatically, so their name, their social security number, date of birth, but if they don't click the save button, I don't think anything past that is saved, unless you know anything behind the scenes can be.
It depends upon the page itself. So mm-hmm. if there were edit checks built in that force something, a value to be made sure that's a value that can be used, then it does do an auto save.
Okay.
So it really just depends upon where they're at in the application, how far they got. But at a minimum, as Derek said, it will always have all their personal data. Okay. But it should also have the college that they applied to. So there's a certain amount that is always saved.
All right. And this, when you exit out, is there a prompt?
Like, yes. Are you sure you want to leave this page?
Yes, it does. And if they click that cancel button, it also gives them that message that says, are you sure you want to cancel it? Because it's not going to save your data if you cancel it.
I think the application in general is amazing. If only we can get past the initial sign-in, login, it is going to be the best thing. I can see it. But I can also see, you know, the delays that we're having at the initial getting started is the only problem with the application is good. Yeah.
Thank you. Well, is the student able to make a copy of the application once they've completed it?
Like printing?
They could print his page.
Okay.
That would be a good recommendation, but that's probably the best they could do within the application itself.
Okay, thank you.
And after we click submit, this is where it's going to do all the logic checks to see this person did. It's going to look again to see the person that people solved, see if it matches the existing student, all this other stuff. It checks it on the front end, but it checks it on this side too. So you can kind of see this little skinny icon in the background. All right. And now it's going to give their ID number and their application number.
That's
the page number. So, and also since I selected the learn on demand questions, yes, it's going to give this online learning survey. So, with the learn on demand, so in addition to those two questions, they also have to fill out this online learning survey, and then they have to answer yes to all those questions, and they would go on and get forwarded to the call center.
So, one question. They get this as soon as they submit the application.
They do.
And then an email, welcome email, comes right after that.
So at this point, they've got two emails. They've got thank you for starting your application. Okay. And for submitting your application.
Okay.
And this one that they got right now is specifically from Jefferson. The first one's kind of a generic one. This one's specifically from Jefferson with all Jefferson's information.
Okay.
And the email has the reference number, but not the IMPL.
That's correct.
So, and that's for security purpose or what?
It is. So with this information, they still have enough to reset their password self-service and all this stuff.
But that just doesn't always work. And then once we get past that, bam, this happens. I'm telling you.
I wish there was a way. I mean, that's the page that they need to hang on to and refer to later. If that, I understand why you can't email that. But if that would be the place to put a message, you may want to print this page for future reference, you know.
Printer friendly.
That's the page they need to hang on to for the rest of their life.
Tattoo. I always tell them it's like their social.
They do, and I tell them to memorize it the same way.
So we can alter that language there. We tell them to write it down, but we can say write or print this page.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Keep this information for future reference. You will definitely need it.
We're close on time. Do we have any time to look at one of the online forms?
I think we have until 10:45, right?
Right, and we're just doing the admission training, so I think we could be flexible on our time.
If everyone else is okay to stay.
Right.
No.
So any questions about the admissions application through this part of it? Again, they should have that welcome email now that's going to tell them, you know, what they need to do to get enrolled at Jefferson. But the next thing I was going to show is an online form. So we talked a lot about the online forms, but you've not really seen those yet. And so these would be for students that have student self-service access. And they may have access to one or several different forms depending on where they are. So if they're, just follow this online forms availability if you want to see specifically. But they'll either have the change of major, change of home college, readmission application, or all three. So the first two, change my major and change my home college, if they're available, will be available in the academics area. The readmission application would be available in the admissions area at the bottom of the page. So this particular student, we can see, has enrollments. So they're enrolled this term. So that's why they don't have access to the readmission application, because they're currently enrolled, and they're obviously not a visiting student, and they're not a high school student. So the forms are pretty similar. So the distinction between these two, I guess, from I guess the student record size more than anything would be, if the student changes their home college, as long as there are no issues, this will go through automatically and make that change. So whenever the student checks as a home college, it's going to happen on the student program plan pages without any intervention. However, the change by major is more like, at this point at least, it's more of an information request. It's more saying, I would like to change my major from art history to whatever else, engineering technology. So, but then somebody in student records or whatever department, we need to go and actually physically make that change. So, I'll kind of walk through both of those. Oh, this one's already got one pending, so. I'll complete that and.
Can you speak on the logic about future dating every one of those changes?
Yeah, so whenever a student tries to change their major or home college, that's always going to be for the next effective term. So now we're in the 4-1-4-6 or the spring 2015 term. Mm-hmm. If a student submits this form, it's going to be effective for the summer 2015 term. There is a checkbox at the end to request that this be made the current term.
Now,
the student has to click that, put a reason in, and it's up to the person on the record side to determine if they want to make that happen. But the reason they don't do that automatically, there's a lot of reasons, but I guess the big one is financial aid. Because, you know, if the students try to change their major to something that's not financial aid eligible, or any number of things that don't complete with, you know, financial aids.
That's why where my question came from. A lot of the financial aid students are coming in with that reason right now. And they're not checking that box. Should we not refer a student to that form if, well, because you can still check that box to say, I need this to happen now.
You don't have to backdate major changes for financial aid anymore.
Yeah, I would love to that to be true, but a lot of times that we've made them do it, they go back to financial aid, and financial aid sends them back down and says, we can't read it. We can't see that there was a change made. So then we look, and we're like, you made the change. It's done. But it's because it's future dated. Financial aid's not looking at that date, or I don't know what. The two sides, that's where I get really mixed up.
I know this came up at the end of the week last week, and I can't remember if it was Amanda or Jennifer talked to Angela.
Okay.
Because I think it's a training issue in the financial aid office.
Okay.
That they're not supposed to have to backdate. Well, that's, yeah, anymore. And so there's been definitely a communication gap or a misunderstanding.
Okay.
But they're cleaning it up.
Cool. Because that's the big thing that we're dealing with right now.
It's very confusing back to students to be told different things.
Yeah.
So.
Well, good. That's good to know.
Sorry, I'm just going to, it's preventing me from doing this because the student already has, I should bring that up too. So if a student has already requested to change their home college or to change their major, but it's pending, so let's say they tried to change their major and somebody's not gone in and done the change yet and they've left that item open in their administration pages. And if a student tries to change their major again, they're going to get that pop-up message that, hey, you have a change pending and you can't do any more requests.
Is that logic different with the changing of home campus? Because they can go in and do that, right? Anytime.
If it hasn't been addressed, if it's suspended, they won't be able to send it.
Another campus change.
But if it went ahead and updated and changed their home college,
then it's it possible. Okay.
I think the difference on that, Melissa, is that the home college is automated,
mm-hmm.
and the change in major goes through records, and they take 48 business hours.
Gotcha.
So yes, you could do a change of home college, and then an hour later...
Change it again.
Change it again, and change it again.
Okay.
All right, so I should be able to change the major now. Oh, of course. I knew it was going to do that, but I tried it anyway. So, people that work at PeopleSoft a lot, you know, if you log in, that's
yep.
Two different IDs. All right, try it again. I didn't clear my internet history, so it's probably not going to let me do it, but... We don't have Firefox on here. Alright, so for those who work in PeopleSoft a lot, this is a good thing to do whenever you're having issues like mine. Look at your browser history and make sure you keep this top one unchecked. So you want to clear your internet files, your cookies, your history. I go ahead and do form data, passwords, and tracking stuff. And clearing all that stuff out makes it a lot easier to log back into PeopleSoft. So if you ever have issues where you have to enter your stuff three different times?
Yeah, that's why.
That's why. It's because you've got stuff that's cached on the back end, and then it's going to give you issues. So now it should work fine. I say that. All right, so now if the student clicks change their major, it shows their current plans, so their practical nursing pending. And it says the change becomes effective. So just like Melissa said, it's going to show the next effective term. So 4152. They pick their program of study. They go to the bottom and continue. Then they pick their plan. Continue. And then at this point, it's kind of an overview screen. They can just click submit. And that's all it is to request to change their major. If they want it to be processed the current term, that's where they have the option, is they want to, they can put a reason in here. So
in order for this to actually be updated, a human has to do that.
Okay.
Right.
So I'm just going to cancel this out so I can show the other one.
Yeah.
So if a student's financial aid was getting hung up because they hadn't declared a major yet, that is what you're going to do, is to have it processed immediately rather than in the future?
That's the idea in the form in asking for that. It depends on what college you are and what financial aid officer you're talking to on whether or not they do backdating or not. Okay. Angela has recently come out and said that we don't have to backdate major changes anymore.
Okay.
That's been recent.
So there's also the change of home college. Pretty similar. The difference, they ask a little bit of personal information, so you confirm your personal information first. And then ask when you would like this to occur. So it lets you choose the next term or the one after that. So if they were going to stay here through the summer, they could request the change happen in the fall. So they could continue as a Jefferson student through the summer term. Then they pick their new college. Then they pick the campus at the next page.
And then is this where the message comes up that says, if you really want to go to Jefferson, you need to not make this change? I mean, I know it doesn't say.
So it doesn't give them any kind of warnings except that they choose the college you're already attending.
Oh.
You're already attending that school. You don't need to do anything. At this point, then they just do like their changes major. They just pick their program of study, and then their plan. Then they can submit it. Then they're finished. They continue, then they're back to their page. And so those are the online forms. The readmission application, a little bit different, has maybe a couple more pieces of information, but it's really similar to the change your home college
So Kim, I got a question then. So if a student wanted to go from Jefferson to Bluegrass, wouldn't they need to apply to Bluegrass versus doing a home college change?
The home college change, according to Sachs and according to others, the home college form serves the purpose of the application. So it can serve that need for your admissions file.
Okay. I was going to say, can we just take the home college out altogether, hoping that you would say, yes, thank you. Okay. I'm sorry.
And the readmission app is the same thing. It will also serve the needs for all reporting purposes as that admissions application.
So
now, many times they're using the readmission form to do the change of college. Mm-hmm. They attended Jefferson, have set out for a while, mm-hmm. now want to go somewhere else.
Okay.
I will say one good thing about the change your home college form is that you're guaranteed to have a good program plan page. Meaning that you're not going to have, if anybody that works with the CPEAP error reports knows that sometimes you can have a blank academic plan description, which is kind of a pain to fix. So you're never going to have that if the student does the change your home college. The reason is they have to select the academic plan that's active at their new institution. So what happens now a lot of times, if we do it from the student record side, we'll go into program plan pages, we'll say the student wants to change their home college, and we'll just change their college.
Not the program.
But let's say that somebody wants to do, let's say, physical therapy assistant. You know, if they're not in Louisville or Somerset, they say they select Bluegrass, and that's their major. They can't have that at Bluegrass, so that's going to have, it's going to cause an error, a CPE error report for that student. Whereas if they choose change my home college, they'll have to select something that's active at whatever college they choose. So if they choose Bluegrass, they'll only have Bluegrass plans available to them. So it does a lot of stuff. It does a lot of nice things we don't appreciate right away. So that's the online forms.
So once we, what if I did some, had someone in person manually and I don't know what Bluegrass offers or everything that they offer. When I select Bluegrass, does it only give me those options?
Perfect. You go and look at the page. You know, if you just change it on the program page mm-hmm. and save it, mm-hmm. it's not going to, you know, you have to actually go look at the plan page Perfect. And put in the new term, put in the requirement term and the mm-hmm. date. Then it's going to let you choose whatever is at Bluegrass. But otherwise, it would not. It would let you save it and cause an error. You have to go look at the plan page.
Right.
When the student does it, it doesn't come back.
All right, do you all have any other questions on form, the application?
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you all for the awesome questions. Really had some good stuff to think about. I think I covered all the stuff on this question.
Heather, I forwarded all your questions to him. I was like, can we cover all of these?
I'm trying to make an effort to go through all those.
Quick question. For the welcome letter that comes in the mail, is that automatically generated in PeopleSoft to go out?
It is.
And like, okay, so within the time frame of the welcome email and the checklist, is it within that? No. Like, what's the turnaround time for that?
7 days.
For the welcome letter to get in the mail?
Let's talk about our letter.
Sorry, no, it's...
So this doesn't come in the mail, right?
That's right.
Okay, I'm like, well, why are we mailing out this?
They get the welcome email.
They get the welcome email.
And a 7-day letter email. But in the letter that says all of our packet of, you know, inserts and all yes. that stuff, that comes from us.
So this comes in, when they submit app, this automatically comes in.
Yeah. So Melissa, what's the goal turnaround from the time they submit their app till mailing out their letter
actually
from us?
From us? Mm-hmm. We said 7 days. We haven't put that in motion yet, though, just to be honest.
That's the goal.
Yes.
I'm sorry. So this welcome letter.
This welcome letter.
That's our letter?
This, no,
this
well,
is a whole different letter.
Yeah. We put yes. about, that's, yeah. mm-hmm. So this is an email, and then the thing they get in the paper mail, the snail mail, comes from us. This is automatically, boom, it comes instantaneously. They hit submit, and this shows up in their inbox electronically. But what comes in their mailbox at their home,
we don't is have that us. Right here, right?
And it's not in front of
it's
you.
Not in here.
That's the third. Okay, and so that's what it's referring to.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, okay.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad y'all are here.
Yeah. Yeah, see, it says in the next week or two, you'll be receiving a welcome letter in the mail from us.
That's our letter.
Yes.
Okay, that's what I was asking. Yep. So that is our letter right there.
Yep.
So, okay, so they get this welcome email, this checklist.
Comes
they
7 days
get,
later.
Okay, so then they are getting this before they get.
No, they get this before they get.
No, I mean our.
Oh, yeah, yeah, for
letter.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
For sure.
And then, of course, it is confusing when you talk checklist because we have our. Checklist of things like our order of events, you know, like testing and orientation versus the to-do list, which is also referred to as a checklist sometimes. So that's a little confusing too, that you may have something in your PeopleSoft to do that's different than going to orientation or something like that. So we have our own
those could be
checklist. Yeah,
here's my steps.
Next yeah.
steps. Yeah.
So your orientation.
So I think this is Jennifer. Is this where we're now transitioning from general to specific?
Yes.
So we're going to take like a little 10-minute-ish break.
Right, because we are all going to move to the library, the admissions office.
Okay, so people who do nitty gritty, they stay. Okay.
Thank you.